my, how time flies. And we're having fun. I didn't realize we got a little over time. And speaking of time, we'll end a few minutes early this evening due to God's will. Life's much easier if you just accept everything that's coming as God's will. Okay, so we are on week number 11 here, and this is a fun one. Reason versus intuition. Truth is one and eternal. Realize oneness with it in your deathless self within. The following commentary is based on the teachings of Paramahansa Yogananda. Jesus, when addressing his critics, appealed to reason and common sense. In his training of the disciples, however, he, like all great masters, encouraged in them the development of a higher faculty, soul intuition. For it is only by intuition that spiritual perceptions are achieved. In chapter 16 of the Gospel of St. Matthew, we find Jesus drawing on the intuition of his disciples by asking them who they thought he was in reality. They immediately understood that what he wanted from them was a subtle answer, not some obvious reply based on his nationality, sex, and the like. Peter it was, at last, who understood and answered the question on its intended level, the spiritual. "Thou art the Christ," he said, "the Son of the living God." And Jesus turned to him, saying, "Blessed art thou, Simon, son of Jonah, for not by human nature was this truth revealed to thee, but by my heavenly Father. And I tell thee this also, thou art Peter, which is to say a rock, and upon this rock will I build my church, and never will the powers of darkness overwhelm it." Jesus was pleased with his disciple for relating to the question on its deepest level. Reason could not have given Peter that answer. The answer came through the faculty of soul intuition, and proved him thereby to be a spiritually advanced disciple. It was his intuitive perception, that insight, which cannot be shaken by tempests of reasonable doubt, that Jesus praised in referring to him as a rock. The church he referred to next was the edifice of cosmic consciousness. Any outer church institution would have to depend, as in fact the Christian churches have always done, on the level of understanding of its individual leaders and members. Peter's intuitive perceptions could never have been passed on to an outward succession of prelates. Clarity comes by direct soul perception. Confusion results from excessive dependence on reason as the guide to understanding. As the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita states, when your intellect, at present confused by the diversity of teaching in the scriptures, become steadfast in the ecstasy of deep meditation, then you will achieve final union with God. Thus, through Holy Scripture, God has spoken to mankind. So, in talking about the intellect versus intuition, or this is reason versus intuition, but really that means the intellect, as it just said in this reading from the Bhagavad Gita, it also means discrimination, which lives here. So, I want to talk about that. And I want to come to something that's common if you're familiar with our teachings, which someone asked Paramahansa, actually it's a long story, but the essence of it is where are these different centers located in the body? Where is the mind located? Where is reason or discrimination located? Where is the ego located? And where is feeling located? And it's an important thing, and I want to go into it in depth here. So first is mon, which lives at the top of the head. This is the mind. And then second is discrimination or reason, and that lives here. Third is the ego, ahankar, which lives here. And fourth is feeling, which lives here. And Paramahansa Yogananda often gave the example of a horse. And he said that you can imagine a horse reflected in a mirror. A mirror is the mind. And then the discrimination comes in and says, well, that's not an apple, that's not a tree, yes, that's a horse. And then the ego comes in, and this is the descent from spirit, back to mon for a second here, which shows us all of creation, that when everything gets very still and calm, and when we rise our energy back up to the top of the brain here, that we can perceive the entire universe, that we realize it within ourselves, as I'm going to get into more deeply. But then as we start descending down, down, then we get to, oh, that's my horse, which really then has separated us from the entire universe. But even still, even in this state of ego, actually, it's true. It's in that state you can see that as the entire universe, you still can see as that's my universe. And this is actually a falling point for very deeply spiritual souls when they achieve Savikalpa Samadhi, and they get the feeling that I'm one with the entire universe, that it's my universe, I can do whatever I want, and that can go on for a long time. Swami Kriyananda said that he achieved Savikalpa Samadhi, he thought, 2,000 years ago, and yet he was still a little bit stuck. Anyway, I don't want to get into the topic of spiritual pride too deeply, but it is something to contemplate. Anyway, let's go down to where most of us are stuck, which is down here, which is in these waves of citta, which say, oh, how happy I am to see my horse. I haven't seen my horse in so long, and now I'm happy. And then, of course, what happens when the horse runs away or dies or whatever happens to the horses? Oh, how sad I am. And these are the fluctuations of the heart. And so by yogas, citta, vritti, nirodha, that we're trying to calm these fluctuations of the heart. In practicing Kriya Yoga, or if you are from a different tradition and you practice any kind of pranayama, that we are trying to learn how to really calm the heart, which means calm the breathing process and the process of pumping blood. I'm not going to get too deeply into that topic, although I love it because it's fascinating that from a physical level we can learn how to go breathless, but that's for a different day, different program. Anyway, let's climb back up the spine and stay on topic here. So, oh, how happy I am to see my horse. But really, the whole beginning of the fall starts right here. And this is with reason. And reason separates and says, it's not this, it's not that. You know, the scriptures say that the entire universe is within you. And I want to look at this deeply. Because as soon as we go here, then we say, well, that's over here and that's over there. Do a mental experiment with me. Mentally zoom up out of your body and fly up as high as you can out into the universe out there and see all these planets whizzing around or solar systems, or go as far out there as you can. Now, mentally realize that even as far out there as you are in the universe, you still are in that somewhere. You can mentally dive right back down through as many levels as you want to go to, and bam, you are right back there. You're always there. And that's, you see, discrimination comes in and takes you, oh, that I'm at the level of a solar system, but you're still in there. And actually, there is no here and there. That solar system's always here right now. Let's reverse it. It might help you. Dive within yourself. Dive deeply in. Go into some little cell. There's 27 trillion cells in your body. Go even deeper into that cell and see all the little parts that are working. And yet, that's within you. That you're always still here. You're always here, it's always now. I don't want to get into time, but if we can just, you know, the scriptures say, the saints say, there is no space. It's a delusion. But it's discrimination that comes in and says, oh, there has to be a here and a there. And that creates this illusion of space. Now, again, these are just words I'm saying. This reading of the Bhagavad Gita, it's great. It says, when your intellect at present becomes confused by the diversity of the teachings in the scriptures, or it's at present confused, but when it becomes steadfast in the ecstasy of deep meditation, then you'll achieve final union with God. So you don't even have to understand what I was just saying about zooming out far into the universe or diving deep within yourself and realizing that space doesn't exist. You're never going to understand that through my words anyways. The way that you are going to understand that is through meditation, is by taking your consciousness and bringing it here back to oneness, and trying to punch through this center as deep as you can in whatever amount that you're able to concentrate there. So that's a little bit on how reason deludes us. And yet, we live in this world and we can't just go wandering around pretending that we're in samadhi all the time, that we have to use our reason. And until, you know, we'll achieve these deep states on the inside in meditation, but then we need to try to take that joy out into the world. We have to live in this world, and we do have to use our reason and our intellect. And it's good to sharpen it. It's good to develop your intellect, that you can practice whatever, learning another language, or practice math problems, or whatever it is that you want to do, but do try to keep your intellect sharp. And I also want to point this out, that as you grow, and as you want to start to grow your intuition, which we'll talk in a minute about how to do that, as you start to grow that, you'll start to want to rely on it more and more. But I've met many people on the spiritual path who get way too much over here on relying on their intuition, which isn't right anyways half the time, and they just decide to leave reason over there as a lesser thing, and they just kind of get off into strangeville. They're just kind of living in a deluded world, and so don't do that. Test your intuition. Test it in little ways before you have to make big decisions based on it. And now this is an important thing. Often people ask, how can I develop my intuition? How can I test my intuition? So, first, meditate. Get your entire being calm and centered. Get your mind up here, focused at the spiritual eye. Then from that point, broadcast. Ask God your question. Ask God, what should I do? Then try to listen very calmly in your heart. And this is a very sensitive science. Because if you have a little desire there in your heart, agitating the heart, it's going to be saying, oh, you definitely should go left. Definitely, definitely, go left, go left. When God might, he talks in silence, really. He talks in whispers of your soul, saying, go right. And so if you're not completely quiet, you'll hear go left, because it's what you want to hear, and it's what your ego wanted to do anyways. Then try it. Go left. And if it works, good. If it doesn't work, then you realize, oh, I was in my own ego. I was deluded by likes and dislikes, by these waves of feeling here in the heart, and I couldn't clearly listen to God's voice. Ask God what he wants you to eat for dinner. Ask God what clothes he wants you to wear today. Some people scoff at that and think, oh, you're bringing him down into the silly little mundane things in life that you should take care of on your own. No. Try to have no separation from God. When you ask of these little things of what he wants from you, then when it comes time, for there's a big decision. Should you move to another city? Should you go with this person as your life partner, as a husband or wife, or whatever these major decisions may be? Should you take a different job? When these big decisions come, again, you want to go in there and meditate, but you will gain confidence in your intuition once you've tested it on little things. Another question comes up, how can you really know that you've received the answer? Because you could meditate for weeks on something and not be sure, okay, was that the answer, or should I keep meditating longer and then get the answer? And you're going to know that by a sureness in your heart. I want to give you one other thing that I do to develop intuition, and that is, I'll go through everything I just said of meditate, get the heart calm, ask from here, listen from here. Then I like to sneak in a little glance over there at a picture of Paramahansa Yoganandaji, of a picture of Swami Kriyananda, and it's in the eyes. It's like a little smile develops on the photograph. The eyes say, yes, yes, I've already given you the answer, you know. And when I get that little feeling, it's more of a feeling, because obviously the picture isn't actually smiling, although sometimes it feels like it is, but when that feeling's really strong, then I just know. And I've learned to trust that, and so far that when it hasn't failed me, that when I really see that smile in the eyes, then I know this is what I need to do. Don't be afraid of that. And as you grow this within yourself, don't be afraid to use it in big decisions. And even if you go wrong with it, it's all right. It's all his show anyways. You can put the blame on him for making you faulty at having a good intuition. And that he likes it when we put the blame on him. And then we say, God, let's try to cooperate better together next time. I'll try to listen better. You try to make this intuition stronger and tell me the answer a little more clearly. And we get there. And slowly we learn how to live our life, and we learn how to progress forward. So that's a little bit on how to develop your intuition, how to know when it's talking. And yet I want to point out again, balance it in the beginning with reason. ask, does this make sense with reason also? That, and you can make it make sense. Reason is slower. That I used to wonder, why did Swami Kriyananda have to edit Paramahansa Yoganandaji's books? That Yoganandaji was a master, that he was directly talking to God. But even in that state, when he would bring down from a state of high consciousness down and filter it into this physical world with words, that mistakes would be made. And so Swami Kriyananda said he, like a plumber, had to fit all those words together so that it would flow and yet still retain his consciousness. Once Paramahansa Yoganandaji told Swami Kriyananda, edit like lightning, but don't change a word. And he was saying, don't change my consciousness. Swamiji was a little confused in the beginning with that one, but then he understood. And so use your reason until your intuition becomes bulletproof. Remember this also, the intuition, because it comes straight from God, is never wrong. And so when we mess it up, either with our distorted heart feelings or by reasoning too much, then it's not true intuition. And slowly, it's part of the path. We learn this as a skill, we grow it, and it makes our life very enjoyable and much easier. That you just know because you know, and you will learn to make big decisions with it, and it turns out great. Now I want to get to this because it's dear to my heart, actually. And this is Christ asking his disciples, that, you know, this person says I'm this person says I'm that, but who do you say that I am? And that one of the disciples, Peter, that he says, well, you're the Christ. And Christ means a title, the anointed one. You're the Son of God. And that Jesus said to him, you are blessed. That it was God who put that thought in your mind because you were spiritually inviting the thoughts of God only. And no one could have told you that. And this is where it gets personal for me and very important for me. Because when I was with Swami Kriyananda, someone who was there also as a brahmachari, left. And I just didn't know what to do with that. And so I went to a spiritual superior and asked, how could this just happen? And he told me this exact story of Christ asking the disciples, yes, but who do you say I am? And I realized that that particular brahmachari hadn't realized who Swami Kriyananda was. And it made me think, do I know who Swami Kriyananda is? And how can I really know who Swami Kriyananda is? And you see, I could ask 100 different people, even people that I felt were very spiritually advanced, who's Swami Kriyananda, and they might tell me different things. But I realized that I had to figure that out for myself, and it's not figure with reason. It goes back to this, why we went to this in the beginning of Mon Buddhi Ahankar Chitta. You have to go into your heart, but a calm heart, and you have to ask, who is that guy? And when you're near a saint and you get in there, you begin to take off the mask. And you realize who he truly is. You realize his omnipresence. And it's something he'll never, I mean, Christ did in this time, but normally the saints, they'll just smile at you. That they know you know, and that's enough. Because even those thoughts, it starts to separate them from God, starts to separate them from you. And you both just smile at one another, knowing we both really don't even exist. That we're both just little dreams of God, and this is all a dream of God. And we just want to remember who is our true Father and who we truly are. And so you have to figure that out for yourself on the inside. And it's easy to get deluded in both ways. It's easy to delude yourself that everybody's a saint, or this guy or that guy's a saint. Or it's easy to just gloss right by the actual true saint, because he doesn't care if you figure out who he is or not. I mean, he wants you to feel joyful, but he doesn't want you to praise him in any special way. He wants to turn your consciousness towards God, however you're going to do that. You know, in some ashrams, if there's all this talk, oh, you seen that guy? He's really the highest. Oh, no. Have you seen this one over there? He's the highest. You know, I was reading the Bible last night, and Christ rebuked his disciples. They would often get into all these, that same nonsense that goes on in the ashrams. No, he's the highest. all the 12 disciples would get into that. Christ would tell them he's the highest, who's the least, who's the most humble, who has the least amount of ego, who just doesn't even get involved in all that chatter and nonsense that goes on in ashrams. Stay out of that. That's not why you go to the ashram. You go there to find God. And you'll figure out the who's who on the inside, and they'll help you. You'll help them. But the talking about that, you know, I used to get engaged in that. I used to tell, oh, my friends, you should go check out that guy, you know? He'll whack you on the chest, put you right in a samadhi, take you right through the game. But it just doesn't work like that. I just rarely talk like that anymore. Because it comes down to those who received him. And so even those saints, that you have to be able to receive that saint. You have to be able to receive that great man or woman of God. And that becomes a personal thing between you and them on levels that aren't really meant to be talked about outwardly. And, again, bringing it back to the topic, you can sit there all day and try and figure out the who's who, who's a saint, who's not, with your reason. It will never get you there. That is the one thing where, okay, use your reason for some things, but when you want to find God, it's just not going to do it. You have to figure out who's the saint that's destined to take you back home to God in your heart, and then you have to believe in that. And there, Satan will try to put everything in your mind of why you shouldn't believe that. And you have to just punch through all of that delusion and get in there and let the guru come in to you. There's a few stories I want to tell, but we'll see how much time allows. But this is one, and it's an important one. And there's a Greek legend about Theseus, and he went into the labyrinth. The labyrinth really is our own human mind. But Theseus went into the labyrinth, but what he took with him is a ball of string, and he unwound it as he went, and he went into the inside, and he killed the Minotaur, which is our own ego, his thought that we're separate. Anything, the thought that we ever could be separate from God. Theseus killed the Minotaur, but then even then, he had to figure his way out of the labyrinth. And he figures his way out by obviously following the string. But that string represents your attunement to your guru. That it's the only way out of this, and that you have to have that attunement, that you have to develop your intuition so that you can find your way out of this mental trap, that reason's just going to jam you up and confuse you. Life's difficult. It's difficult just to find your way out of some kind of difficult labyrinth or maze. Yes, reason can eventually get you out of that. The maze of your own desires, of your own thoughts, thinking this is going to make me happy, that's going to make me happy. Only one way out. Anyway, that's my time is up. Unfortunately for this evening, were there questions?
There is one.
We'll fit it in. It'll be all right. What is it?
Oh, is concentrating on the right eye of the guru helps in developing intuition? Left eye is for what?
If concentrating on the right eye of the guru helps to develop intuition, then the left eye
is kind of both questions.
Is what?
Like, it's
yes,
both the questions.
You have asked a question that is way beyond my ability, and I'm so happy for you. However, I have to look this one up in what I call the scriptures, which is the Raja Yoga book, and I have some other teachings of Master on this, that each eye does have something like that, and you've tuned into that, and I will look that up, and I will get back to you. It's a great question. It's a fun one. I like all of these different things like that. I will get back to you on that one. Until then, friends, it's been a wonderful evening, and go back into your homes, go back into sleep this evening, the greatest joy and the greatest peace of God.